Friday we went through some examples of the superposition of different plane potential flows. Specifically, we talked about Rankine half bodies, which are the superposition of a uniform flow and a source. We talked about Rankine ovals, which are a source and an equal strength sink in a uniform flow. And we talked about how to model flow around a circular cylinder using a doublet in a uniform flow. One led to some observations that we didn't really have time to go into with much depth. The idea is if you throw a doublet into a uniform flow, what you get is, as we showed, a cylinder. And if you say, all right, now I have a stream function, now I have a potential flow function, therefore I have velocities everywhere, you can apply the Bernoulli equation to get an expression for the pressures around the surface of the cylinder as a function of the angle measured from the, or the angle measured from the positive x-axis. And if you plot out the solution from the potential flow solution, what you see is you get this symmetric distribution of pressures, whereas measurements, experimental measurements, represented by this dashed line, aren't quite the same. So two things come from this. The first is that this potential flow pressure distribution leads to what's known as D'Alembert's paradox, which says that if we model the flow around a cylinder, the model tells us there are no forces on the cylinder. It says there's no drag and there's no lift because the lift, the pressure distribution is symmetric. Same pressure acting on this face as on this face. And so this highlights one of the shortfalls of potential flow analysis, because in reality, as shown by these experimental results, what happens is that viscosity forces flow to detach here, and you end up with this recirculating eddy region, which causes pressure losses. So there's an example of where you cannot quite get away with potential flow analysis very well. The last one we did not get to is what happens when you throw a vortex into the middle of your doublet. So this is the flow around a cylinder, similar with just a doublet and a free stream. And then if you add a free vortex into the expression from here or here, then what you start to get is rotation of the flow added on top of that cylinder. It doesn't change the size of the cylinder. All it does is it changes the streamline distributions around it, and it changes the locations of the stagnation points. And so what you get now is if you were to plot out your velocities, your radial velocity is still going to be zero ever on the velocity, but now your tangential velocity contains the component that came from the flow around the cylinder plus this rotational element from a free vortex. And what this allows us to do is here I have a modeled flow around go. Alright. So what we're looking at here are the streamlines that result from a doublet. The streamline equal to zero is shown as a bold black line, so that's the body boundary and any points where there's no cross flow, right? So we see that here's the formation of the doublet, and then the introduction of a vortex spinning like so has produced curvature in the streamlines. And then what I've also done is said, all right, I have the stream function, I have the potential flow function, therefore I have the velocities, and it allows me at every point in the flow to figure out what the pressures are through the Bernoulli equation, right? And so the contours here, the colors show kind of the qualitative distribution of pressures. And it may be a little hard to see here, but what happens is that just like before, you have a buildup of high pressure here and here, but then you have a low pressure here and an even lower pressure here. So as a result, you end up with a lift being generated on the body. So one of the ways, by the way, in which you can sort of tell where velocities are highest, remember we established that if you take two streamlines, then the difference between the constant stream function on each of those streamlines gives you the rate of flow between the two streamlines. As a result, when you have equally spaced streamlines like this, these are all equally spaced values. If you have equally spaced streamlines, then when they get closer and closer together, that means the same amount of flow is being squeezed through a smaller space, essentially. So streamlines being closer together means the flow is speeding up. And faster flow means lower pressures. So as a result, when you have wider spacing here, it means higher pressures, lower pressures. As a result, you end up with a net positive lift. So this leads to what we call the Magnus effect, which tells us that if we were to integrate the pressures around the surface of the body, we have still zero drag, but now we have lift that is equal to negative fluid density times the fluid free stream velocity times the circulation of the vortex that we put at the middle of the doublet. All right. Note that the lift here actually acts perpendicular to the incoming flow, which means, and notice this negative sign here, which means that if we have flow in the positive x direction, and we have let me put that the other direction. We define x, y. So if we define positive circulation, that is by the right-hand rule, what this tells us is positive flow, positive circulation, our lift is actually going to be negative. Whereas if we were to define a negative circulation by the right-hand rule, right, then the lift is going to actually be the upward direction, which gives us a little bit of insight. This explains the physics behind the idea of like a fastball, right, with backspin. And that's actually precisely, this is a video that maybe some of you guys have seen before, demonstrating just how much of an effect, the Magnus force can have.
They dropped a basketball over the edge. You can see that the basketball gets pushed around a bit by the breeze, but it lands basically right below where it was dropped. Now watch what happens when they drop another basketball, but this time with a bit of backspin.
Whoa, look at that go!
That's incredible.
So you want those to get back in the water, do you?
Something like 140 meters tall. Ball dropped up here, path out here, and it traveled almost 70 meters, right? Horizontally, with just a little bit of backspin. As a result of Magnus effect. Another application where we see this in marine flows is what we call Magnus effect stabilizers. So, ships, when they're not moving, or when they are moving, for that matter, one of the big pipe dreams of a naval architect is to design a really smooth running ship that has very well controlled rolling motions, right? When you're moving, it's not that hard. You stick a couple of hydrofoils on the side, a couple of fins that you use to control the rolling motion, these roll stabilizers. When there's no forward velocity on the ship, wings or fin-like structures aren't very good at generating lift, so they don't do a very good job of canceling out rolling motions, which is where this company called Quantum Marine creates these bizarre-looking but actually quite effective stabilizers that are just cylinders that rotate in one direction and sweep, then rotate in the other direction and sweep, and then rotate in one direction and sweep. And so these things literally just wave around while spinning enough in different directions in order to generate lift upward or downward in order to cancel out rolling motions of a vessel. This also forms the basis of airfoil theory, right? There's a whole branch of mathematics that allows us to take a shape like this, and using complex analysis and a mapping function, we can actually do this complex mapping of this thing into a plane of, if you say this is x, this is complex I times y, you can turn this shape into a cylinder or into a circle, and while maintaining a uniform flow, representing flow, and then when you turn this thing at an angle of attack, what happens is you impart rotation to the cylinder. And the math actually tells us that these two systems are equivalent under certain assumptions. And what we get then is that by placing this at an angle of attack, we end up with an effective circulation developed around an airfoil section that gives us lift. Okay, so the real point of today's lecture, though, is to cover the remainder of chapter 6, which is viscous flow. So this is going to be, for the first half, a little bit derivation heavy, and then for the second half, we're going to talk about some example problems. Alright, and then I'll use whatever time is left to talk a little bit about how we take this knowledge into kind of an introduction to CFD. So, the thing is, for most of this chapter so far, we've gotten away with ignoring viscosity, right? We've said, well, we model something, we say, oh, there are shear stresses, what happens if we set this to zero? We get Euler equations. Oh, we have Euler equations, what happens if we assume irrotationality and such? We get the stream function and potential flow function. But in reality, this isn't a very good assumption for modeling really detailed flows, because we have what we call no-slip conditions, things where the flow along solid particles tends to stick to that solid surface. Additionally, we're not even able to solve for really simple problems like flow through a pipe. This is really slow flow going through a pipe section of oil with sort of a trace of coloring added across it. What we see is we end up with this distribution of velocities developing that because there is a gradient across the pipe, implies there's rotation of the flow, and therefore we are not able to deal with it with any of the theories that we've been developing so far this chapter. So even something as simple as two-dimensional or one-dimensional flow through a pipe, we can't do it yet. So that's what we're going to fix today. In fact, this is the first example we're going to do is showing that we can actually get the exact solution for this problem. All right. So if you recall, returning to sort of the way we get our general equations of motion, right? We said we have a fluid element. Let's apply conservation of linear momentum, which means we need to account for all of the forces acting on it. We need to write out the expression for acceleration. This is really just F equals ma on a small scale. Surface forces, recall we had those caused by the shear stresses on the body and the normal stresses. So if we wrote out a fluid element, we would have all the normal and tangential shear stresses acting on the fluid element, which we write out as this expression, this rate of change of normal and shear stresses times the fluid element volume. A gravitational body force is just rho times the fluid element volume times the component of gravity in that component direction. And then finally, our acceleration term we can write as rho times the fluid element volume times acceleration, this being small m, acceleration. However, because we're talking about the acceleration of a fluid particle, we need to write this as a material derivative, a Lagrangian time derivative, that is saying not how fast is the acceleration at a point in space, but how fast is the acceleration of this fluid element. And then by using the Lagrangian time derivative, we can turn this into a field representation where we can say, all right, so now we get, oh, sorry, these are supposed to be in. These should be in parentheses. So what we say now is we say, okay, we have fluid forces caused by normal and shear stresses. Gravitational body forces are equal to the small elemental mass times local and advective accelerations. So this allows us to express everything in an Eulerian frame now. Okay, and then the last thing we do is we recognize that we have this delta x, delta y, delta z in all of these terms. We kill those off, and what we end up with are the generalized equations of motion. So what we did with this next was we said, okay, this includes everything we can think to throw at the problem, right? We have all of the forces we can think to include, and we have accelerations on this side. We got to the Euler equations by saying, forget viscosity, we don't like shear stress, kill everything with a tau, and we end up with these simplified expressions, which are still pretty nasty, right? What we're gonna do now is add those components back in, all these taus. We're gonna figure out how to express those in terms of velocity components. So let me black this out for a moment. So at the very beginning of the chapter, we talked about fluid element kinematics, right? We said that we have something like fluid element, that it can undergo general motion and deformation to go from this shape to this shape, which we said is the superposition of four types of kind of basic motions. And it's your guys' turn to remember what those are. So general motion can be formed from what four components of motion of fluid element? Translation, this one, yes. These are both sort of rigid body elements, right? This is convection with the flow. This is caused by rotation of the flow.
Deformation. Linear deformation.
Exactly, yeah. Linear deformation. And the last one. Angular deformation. All right. So we've pretty well dealt with translation, right? Because this just follows from V. We've dealt with rotation because this pretty much follows from, right? What we haven't dealt with is linear deformation and angular deformation. We've assumed that we don't end up with, these are the terms that usually give us some sort of shearing stress or viscous stresses on a fluid element. So we're going to concentrate now on dealing with these two. So the way we do so is, if you recall, here's our undeformed fluid element. Say we've got say it's deformed into this sort of diamond shape. We said that we could measure these two angles independently, call them alpha and beta. Right? And we said we're interested in ways of combining the rate of change of alpha and the rate of change of beta. This one's defined positive this way, this one's defined positive this way. So what we said is, if we take the difference of these two, then if you take this one, if we sum these two in the sense of positive overall rotation, beta is actually a positive beta corresponds to a negative rotation, just because the way that it's been drawn here. But say x, this is y. Then saying that delta beta, delta t plus delta alpha, delta t, if we combine the two, we have to put a negative sign in front of that, so we can't put back it's negative. And this leads to our fluid rotation vector, which is equal to delta u, delta y minus delta v, delta x. Or, sorry, partial u, partial y. Taking the, that represents sort of the average rate of rotation of this entire element. That is, that tells us how quickly this line is spinning. So if this is 0, that is, if delta u, delta y, delta b, delta x are equal, or alpha and beta are equal, that means this thing's not rotating, it's just getting squeezed. And that's the condition we did not really look at yet. So that's where it led us to what we call the strain rate vector, which is equal to, delta alpha, delta t plus delta beta, partial alpha, partial t, plus partial beta, partial t, equal to plus partial t, partial x. So this is our fluid strain rate. And the reason we care about this is, remember, if this is equal to 0, this means that this rotation is equal to this rotation over here, and the thing's just rotating as a solid body. There's no deformation on it. If this is equal to zero, that means that it's not rotating at all, it's just getting deformed, and some combination of the two equals some combination of our rotation and our angular deformation. If we go ahead and we write, however, if we write this as a tensor expression, then we're actually able to get both our linear and angular deformation terms kind of wrapped up in one. So we say, ij is equal to partial of vi xj plus partial of vj. So what this describes is essentially a matrix, right? Which gives us the rate of strain when I and J are not the same indices. That is, we say that V1 is equal to U, V2 is equal to V, V3 is equal to W, right? X1 is equal to X, X2 is equal to Y, X3 is equal to Z. It's just the indicial notation makes this a little bit easier. But what we see now is, so if we plug in a 1 and a 2 here, we get UV, XY. That gives us the same expression we wrote out here. If we plug in a 1 for both indices, then what we get is, we'd get DU, DX plus DU, DX, with the 2 DU, DX, which is actually twice our linear deformation term. So don't worry if this all seems a little bit scattered and confusing at the moment. The idea is we've just shown that our translation term we get just through convection with the velocity, rotation, comes out from this expression, and now both of these terms at once can be expressed using this tensor notation, which just tells us how much the fluid element is being stretched and sheared and squeezed. All right? So I'm going to leave this up here. Who remembers the fundamental difference between fluids and solids, specifically solids and Newtonian fluids? Right. Solids, stress is equal to some, or is proportional to strain, right? And that proportionality constant is what we call Young's modulus. In fluids, it's not equal to strain, it's equal to the strain rate times our dynamic viscosity. So what we do here now is, before in when we were working in one dimension, we got away with just saying, you know, tau yx was equal to u du dy. We're sort of left scratching our heads wondering how you do this expression, or how this expression is generalized to more than one dimension. Now we finally have a way of expressing our strain rate, and we're left with tau is equal to our dynamic viscosity times this double under bar here. I'm just using it as a notation to say that this is a matrix for a second order tensor. This tells us is that tau ij is equal to mu dui dxj plus duj dxi. All right. This is big. This is useful. We now have some way of relating the velocity gradients to stresses on a fluid element. the next big step we have to take is saying, all right, how does this fit into our idea of surface forces and body forces on an element? So if we consider our fluid element here, we'll say it's still, we'll skip the detailed derivation. We'll still say that this has some small body force, which is equal to small volume times rho times g, right? And what we have now is acting on this face. We say this is x, this is y. What's your stress component? Did we say this was before? This is tau. Give me tau xy, right? Which, applying that expression over there, is going to be equal to mu times d, that's 1, 2, yeah, d u d, d u b, d x. On this face here, we then have tau y x, which is equal to mu dv dx plus du dy. No, these two are equal to one another, right? They're just, the order has been flip-flopped. And so what this tells us about our stress tensor is that, fact one, it's symmetric, right? Flipping the indices, changing j and I, is only going to change the order in which these two components are written. They're still being added together, so you're going to get the same sum. All right, so they're symmetric. These are the shear stresses on these two faces. We also have, though, sigma xx, which is equal to 2 mu du dx. Is there anything else? So this is just comes from our stress tensor. So anything else acting on the face, normal to the face's area here? What did we build the Euler equations on? Right? What did we plug in for our normal stress here? Pressure, right? This has nothing to do with pressure. This is a viscous stress. And pressure acts, a positive pressure acts as a negative, negative normal stress, right? So we say minus P. Up here, we'd say sigma yy is equal to minus p plus 2 mu delta v delta y. So, if we were to write this whole thing out, and that's what I'm going to do now, we could say that the normal stresses, or that the surface stresses on the body are equal to All right. So this is how we write our surface forces divided by an area that is all our surface stresses. And just for the sake of convenience, we often just combine these P's over here and write the entire thing as our shear stress tensor. We, in other words, just absorb these pressures into our shear stress tensor. So we can understand from this that this is the component due to pressure, right? Isotropic, acts equally in all directions, causes no shear stress. You only have entries along the diagonal because it only acts as a normal stress. Over here, we have the viscous contribution to stresses caused by linear deformation, that is elongation, and shearing of the fluid element. This guy, you don't need to, I don't think you need to worry about copying down word for word, because we're about to put up all of the individual components, which are also, well, this is what we end up getting out of it, right? Is that all of our normal stresses can be summed up. And these are on the PowerPoint, this is on the PDF slides that are uploaded on Canvas as well. Right. So all of our normal stresses can be written as a sum of pressures, and the viscous effects of linear deformation, shear stresses written as the viscous effects of shear deformation, and they are all symmetric. Okay. This is how we write them out in Cartesian coordinates. In cylindrical coordinates, we use the same vector expressions, but just because polar coordinates, we end up with the extra r's, 1 over r's, etc. So, where we're going with this now is that if I need to pull this back up. Alright, one more deformation, or one more derivation to get through. And then we get on to using these equations. Okay, so we have expressions now for all of our surface stresses. And we have our general equations of motion for conservation of linear momentum, or they come from conservation of linear momentum. So let's just look at the x component of our equations of motion first. X component. We had rho gx x, sigma x, partial y, tau y, partial z, tau z, x, so 2, rho, This was what we derived before. What we didn't know is how to relate these to our velocities, right? We now have the tool to make that connection in form of the Newtonian shear stress tensor. So let's go ahead and just concentrate on the left-hand side here and start making some substitutions. Gravity will don't need to worry about too much because that's gonna stay the same. So just pulling this portion here out and rewriting it, we end up saying that this is equal to partial x sigma xx, which we had before, equal to negative pi or negative p plus 2 mu du dx plus partial y mu du dy plus dv dx plus partial z So what we've done is we've taken those expressions for Newtonian shear stresses and plugged them into each of these components. All right. Now distributing. This isn't that color anymore. All right. Now what we're going to go for is try to collect all of our second derivatives. So we can see here we have a partial x of something with a partial x, right? So let's go ahead and underline that around. Partial y's here, so let's take that term. Z's here, that term. And then all of our kind of cross derivatives, where we have mixed y, x, etc. Take that, and that. So, let's expand this all out first. This is equal to negative partial x plus 2 mu partial squared u partial x squared plus mu partial squared u partial y squared plus mu squared v partial x partial y plus mu partial u squared partial z squared plus mu squared w partial x partial z. Alright, now we want to take everything has a partial y squared, partial z squared, and we'll take one of these partial x squareds, and we'll take the other partial x squared, which can be thought of as a partial x, and we'll take these other cross terms, partial x, partial y, partial x, partial z, and we'll split these up, kind of write them out into two groups. Those groups we'll have negative partial p partial x plus u partial squared u partial x squared plus partial squared u partial y squared plus partial squared u partial z squared plus partial x plus partial v partial y plus partial w partial z. Okay. Where these components have come from the blue over there, these components have come from the brown underlines. Thing we want to note here is this expression right here. Let me make that a little bit nicer. This is equal to the divergence of the velocity field, right? Which for an incompressible fluid we've said is equal to zero, right? So by doing this grouping, we can say if this entire term is equal to zero, we knock out this entire group of terms. allows us to write. I'll go ahead and plug it back into the full equation of motion. So that gives us now the x component of the resulting equations, which we call the Navier-Stokes equations, be written as rho gx minus partial p partial x plus mu partial squared u partial x squared partial squared u partial y squared plus partial squared u partial z squared is equal to rho partial u partial t plus v dot nabla b. All right. So this is the x component. Y component, we go through the very same process and we end up with everything but with v's here, right? Plugging in all those strain rate expressions in, we get the Navier-Stokes equations in x, y, and z, which are the same things I just derived. Right? In this case, the acceleration terms are written on the left, right? This is our mass per unit volume, acceleration, pressure force per unit volume, gravity force per unit volume, shear stress or shear forces per unit volume. So written in x, y, and z, they're kind of daunting, they're messy, they're big. But if we look at just, as I said, just in the x directions there, we can boil all the x, y, and z directions down actually into this expression right here, which expresses the entirety of the Navier-Stokes equations as one, where we've got our local acceleration, our advective acceleration, the pressure, weight, and viscous terms, and likewise in the vector form, we have our local and advective accelerations, pressure, weight, and viscous terms. All right, so we've gone through, we've derived these equations. The next thing to ask is, how many equations do we get out of this, and how many unknowns are represented by these equations? What are we actually trying to find? What's the point of writing all these equations if we don't know what we're looking for? So, for this purpose, let me roll back here. Who wants to tell me what some of the unknowns are? Like if we write out these equations, they're equations of motion, right? Just like any equations of motion or a differential equation. Usually you write it out with differential equations like a spring mass damper or something. You might have like y double dot and y double dot plus ky equals zero, right? Our unknown here is y, right? We're writing a differential equation in terms of our unknown. We have one unknown, we have one equation, we can solve it. In this case, we've got a whole lot of mixed derivatives, partial derivatives, nonlinear terms, but it's the same idea. They're still written in terms of some of the things that we're looking for out of the problem. And when we're talking about fluid flow problems, we're usually interested in like the forces the fluids are going to exert, which are caused by what? Pressures, usually. Okay. So one of those could be pressure.
Acceleration.
Well, the acceleration could be We could talk about being interested in the acceleration, but more basically, you know, if we let's take back, like, go back at a derivative there, velocities, right? So our u, v, and w, basically everything that this is written in terms of.
Well,
so
wouldn't the acceleration be the second derivative? That's why the partial square y partial square, that's then the acceleration.
Well, these here are not accelerations. These are viscous stress components, right? This has been written with ma on this side and f on this side in this case, but you're right in that, like, this is an acceleration term, and these are viscous stress terms.
Yeah, yeah.
But the thing to note here, this is kind of a subtle point, I'm glad you brought that up, is we could write it in terms of acceleration, right? But then we have other things that are still terms of velocity, and so we end up with more unknowns. Now we have acceleration and we have velocity. So then if we didn't have the Navier's or the Newtonian stress assumption, we also have shear stresses. We have another 9 unknowns. So what we did is we said, all right, we have a shear stress relationship, which puts all the shear stresses in terms of velocities. And we have our kinematics, our material derivative, which puts our accelerations in terms of our velocities. And so everything has been cast into some function of velocity components and pressure. So we have pressure, we have u, we have v, and we have w. 4 unknowns. Ruh-roh. We only have 3 equations, right? Where's our 4th equation come from? We have been using it all along, by the way, throughout the entire chapter. These are conservation of linear momentum, right? These are the equations of motion. What's the other conservation law that we've been relying on pretty heavily? Conservation of mass, right. So we have conservation, linear momentum, 3 equations, and conservation of mass, which gives us 1 equation. So we end up with 4 and 4. So it's a closed system. It's sufficient. You know, we could solve for everything we're interested in, except that you know, we have the right number of equations, the right number of unknowns. So we have established all the relationships, but those relationships are just nasty. As I said, these are the worst. If you ask a mathematician one of the hardest kinds of partial or of differential equations to solve, I'm going to tell you nonlinear coupled partial differential equations, and these are the sort of the standing classic example, which is why there are no general solutions to this. There's no textbook way of solving this for an arbitrary flow problem. If you came up with one, you would be one of the grand challenge winners of, like, the scientific community. There are these standing challenges where you win like $10 million and have your name written in every book, and you'd go down as a giant of history. But right now there are a collection of maybe, written out in cylindrical coordinates. Same reasoning applies. It's just a transformation.
Can you go back a slide?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Son?
No.
Forward.
That one, yeah.
Okay. There are, in fact, maybe 50 to 80 known problems for which we can actually solve these equations. And those are only solvable because something about the problem allows us to cancel a bunch of terms out. And so what we're going to do for the rest of this lecture is talk about 2 example flows that can be solved exactly. And as they allow us to cancel out the right number of terms, those just don't exist in the problem, and what we end up with is something that we can actually deal with. So, the first of these is going to be flow between parallel plates. And I'm going to take advantage of the fact that Navier-Stokes equations are already written up there, so I don't have to rewrite them. So if you remember the sort of motivating slide, I showed the example of flow of oil through a pipe or between two plates and how it kind of takes on this parabolic velocity distribution. That is this problem, essentially. So the assumption here is we have two fixed plates. These are not moving. We have a viscous fluid between them with some velocity u, but we don't know how this velocity is distributed across the section. And the origin here of our coordinate system is defined at the center line of the pipe, which is 2h wide, or not necessarily pipe, but parallel plates. Okay, we're assuming that the plates are infinitely long and wide. That is that the problem is essentially two-dimensional. We don't have to worry about this direction. We're assuming the flow is steady and laminar. The fluid flows only in the x direction. That is, there's no w and no v components to the velocity. And we're assuming that u is only a function of the y component. That's what's called fully developed flow. That means that the velocities over here are the same as the velocities over here, and there's no dependence on how far out of the board we are. Okay, so given this information, what simplifications can we make to these equations? There's a whole bunch of cancellations that we can make. Well, we're only interested in the x component of the flow, but it's good practice to go ahead and keep all the conservation and linear momentum, because we'll see some of the hydrostatics equations and such fall out of it. That's equal to zero. We're going to say that that's equal to zero and that's equal to zero. Essentially, all of our unsteady terms, right, go to zero. We know that u is only a function of y, right? So all our cross derivatives, u by u by x, u by z, right? These can all go to zero. We know that v and w are both zero, which means that goes to zero. V, 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 w, 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 w. So this is, like I said, this is an example of why we love certain kinds of problems that allow us to cut out a lot of the complexity. Okay. The last thing is gravity. We're saying that gravity only occurs in the y direction, as it's vertical. So gx or gz is 0. And I think that is about all we can cancel out. That's right. All right. So these lead to This leads to three equations for the x component, y component, z component. We'll say a tells us negative partial p partial x plus mu d squared u d y squared is equal to zero. B tells us negative rho g minus partial p partial y is equal to zero. And C tells us that negative partial p partial z is equal to zero. If we were to integrate each of these the respective number of times, what we would get here out of this one, we would see that pressure is equal to negative rho gy plus some function of x plus constant, right? Well, actually, that comes from these two. If we were to integrate both of these to solve for pressure, what we get is our hydrostatic term, right? That is, the pressure is going to be equal to the pressure at the center line plus the hydrostatic component plus some change pressure in x, which comes from our dp dx there. All right, so that so to kind of answer your question, Joe, that's all that comes out of using the y and z components there, is we're able to see how pressure varies with depth. It's useful in general, maybe not for this problem, you know, we don't care that much, but it's a good idea to write out x, y, z components, cancel everything out, and see, because there are certain problems where you'll find that one of the things that's unknown here shows up in one of these, even if you're not interested in the y momentum, right? All right. So now we want to solve A there. So integrating, we have d squared u dy squared is equal to 1 over mu partial t partial x. That is, I just rearranged what's over there. This allows us to write, then integrating once, we get u partial y is equal to 1 over mu partial t partial x y plus call this constant A, and integrating one more time, we get u is equal to 1 over mu, 1 over 2 mu, partial p, partial x, y squared plus a, y plus b. And what we had over here is just an ordinary differential equation. Integration twice. What we end up with is now an expression for u with two unknown constants. So this is what we call a boundary value problem, right? We say, all right, I can solve the integral, or I can solve the differential equation, but now I have two constants that I can only find by looking at the values of this thing at the edges of the problem. So our two boundaries are the two walls. And because this is viscous fluid, what do we know about, what does the no-slip condition tell us about the velocity at these two walls? It's equal to zero, identically zero. So what we're going to do now is plug in positive h and negative h in for y, and say that both of those are equal to zero, and what we'll get is our expressions for a and b. So writing those in for positive h, we get 0 is equal to 1 over 2 mu partial p partial x h squared plus a h plus b, and at negative h we have 0 equals 1 over 2 mu p partial x h squared minus a h plus b. All right, if we add these two things together, this system of equations, we add them together, what we get is 2b plus 1 over 2 mu partial p partial x h squared is equal to 0. Right, which tells us that B is equal to negative 1 over adding these together, we get rid of the 2 there. Sorry. So, b is equal to 1 over 2 mu, partial p, partial
supposed to be x.
x h squared. So there's one of our constants. The other one we get by subtracting this from this, which gives us 2a h is equal to 0, which means that a must be equal to 0. So plugging these two expressions, or these two constants in up here, what we get is u is equal to 1 over 2 mu partial p partial x y squared minus h squared. Here's our expression. So does this look... Oh, that's nice. Should have known about that. Alright, so returning back to the problem statement. The question is, if this is the flow we're simulating, or the rate that we are assuming to exist, does this behavior look like what we've derived right here? I think that the answer could be probably yes, right? We've said here that the y is measured from the center line, right? So if we plug in a positive or negative h for this, this goes to 0, u goes to 0. Yes, that works. At the point where the velocity is going to be maximum here is if h equals 0 at the center line. That's preserved. And we can see because we have the squared here, it's got a parabolic distribution. Right? So the result is that, yes, we have managed to recover a flow velocity that one's vertical, this one's horizontal, but that between two parallel plates looks like this. And this is the well-known and classic example of what we call laminar, fully developed flow between two pipes. This parabolic velocity distribution. And it all depends on this term right here, this pressure gradient. So what this tells us is that if pressure over here P1, P2, that if P1 equals P2, this pressure gradient will be 0 and the velocity will stop. That makes sense, right? There's nothing to push the fluid through the pipe. If pressure 1 is greater than pressure 2, this greater than this x direction, that means that we actually end up with a negative here, right? Partial pressure is going to be negative. When we get it, then is equal to 1 over 2 mu partial p partial x h squared minus y squared. And this actually gives us this is the one that actually gives us an expression that the expression that we're looking for in terms of positive, where if we plug in the 0 for y, we now have a positive u. Okay, and if pressure 1 is less than pressure 2, then we have this expression where at y equals 0 at the center line here, our velocity is going to be u 1 over 2 pi, 2u dp dx times negative h squared. So it's going to be pointing in this direction. So this tells us that flow goes in reasonable directions according to our solution. It's got the parabolic velocity distribution that we see in physical experiments like this. So, you know, pat yourselves on the back. We have managed to solve our very first fluids problem without making any simplifying assumptions. Okay. This is the exact solution we've actually said. Here are all of the physics we can think to include. We have just come up with a simple enough problem that that we can solve it. All right. The next one and last one here is that we're going to talk about today is what we call couette flow. Oh, well, that's obnoxious. It's already written up there. I was going to make you guys do it, but I guess we're kind of running out of time. So this is a case where if we say exact same geometry, but now we allow this top plate to be dragged along at some steady velocity, capital U. All right. Nothing in our physics has changed. Our governing equations stay the same. Our assumptions all stay the same. And so we have the exact same form of the solution right here. Right? We have the same, the only thing that's changed are our boundary conditions. Now instead of a zero velocity here, we have a velocity of U. So... Whereas before we had the no slip condition, now we have no slip condition at the bottom boundary, and we have a set velocity at the top boundary. So at y equals negative h, we still have u equals 0, which is equal to 1 over 2 mu, partial p, partial x, h squared minus a h plus b, and at y equals positive h, we have u equals the velocity at which the top plate is being dragged, which is calling big U, the 1 over 2 mu, partial p, partial x, h squared plus a h plus b. All right, same trick. Adding these together or subtracting them, what we end up with the other change we're gonna make here, let me swap this out a little bit. Wanna change our coordinate system. Bottom plate stays fixed. Top plate is moving with the velocity u. Now instead of putting our origin at the center line, we're just going to go ahead and move the origin down here to the bottom, right? This doesn't change anything in the way we've solved the problem so far. It doesn't change this. It just changes where we apply our boundary conditions. So now our bottom boundary condition is going to be at y equals 0. And our top boundary condition is going to be, we'll say that this is now by. So at y equals b. All right, so plugging these in now, we get 0 and 0, which tells us b equals 0. Make sense? B here, we end up, instead of h, plug in a b, and what this leads to is expression of and we've already got that b is equal to 0. So we get a is equal to big U over b minus 1 over 2 mu partial p partial x b. So now we plug this in to here. We get the solution. U, y is equal to 1 over 2 mu, partial p, partial x, y squared plus u, y B, minus 1 over 2, mu, partial P, partial X, B, Y. Which can be simplified into 1 over 2, mu, partial P, partial X, Y squared, minus BY, plus mu, Y over B. So now, as a function of partial P, partial X, the width between the two plates and the speed which the upper plate is being dragged along, we can write out the velocity distribution across the gap. And one example where this comes into play, that this is actually a useful equation, is, for example, if we were to solve this in not in Cartesian coordinates like we just did, but if we did the same problem in cylindrical coordinates, if you think of the example of a bearing, right? A bearing shaft. Sitting in a journal, and if there's no weight on this bearing, if it's an unloaded bearing, then what you have is this thing moving around, so it has a local velocity equal to, if this thing is rotating it with an angular velocity of omega, it has some velocity here, and the bearing journal is fixed, then what you have is essentially a rotational analog to what we just solved. Instead of two infinitely long plates, you have two curved surfaces. So this is the classic Couette flow, and you can actually draw out, if you were to divide the entire thing by this big U, then what you've done is you've said velocity over velocity has units of nothing, right? No dimensions. This is simply a scalar value, meaning that everything on this side of the equation is also a scalar value. Everything here is, they had the dimensions removed. So you have y over b, b squared over 2 mu u, partial p partial x, y over b. And what this shows is that we've actually written the solution without dimensions in terms of these two groups, y over b, and what's contained right here, this b squared over 2 mu u partial p partial x. And this is sort of a preview of what we're going to be doing in chapter 7, where we say, all right, we have some known equation or some unknown equation, and we have a bunch of dependencies on things like u, b, mu, partial p partial x, combined in different forms. And by being smart and reorganizing these terms, we can write a solution in terms of a reduced number of dimensionless groups. So in this case, you can actually plot out u over big U for any problem as a function of y over b, which is what's on the x-axis here, and then this expression right here, this b squared 2 mu u partial p partial x, which is what are shown by these different curves. So you have now only two dimensionless groups, so you can write out your universal solution to this form in terms of those two dimensionless groups. For example, if there's no pressure gradient, this tells us that this entire term disappears, and what we end up with is just u over big U is equal to y over b. That is, we end up with a linear curve. Right. So as I said, this is an example of a flow that could, for example, represent the velocity distribution in the oil of an unloaded bearing. Other simple flows that we can solve with Navier-Stokes in its exact form include things like the flow through an actual circular pipe. That would be applying the first problem, that is flow between two plates, but instead of solving Cartesian coordinates, you assume that it's axisymmetric and solve that same problem with in the radial coordinate. Things like flow down inclined planes, flow down inclined planes when there's some porous material that has velocity going through it in one direction or another. An example would be flow down like a gravel bed where some water is leaking through the gravel. You can do things like, I'm having a brain fart coming up with other exact solutions. The idea is there exists a very small selected group of problems where the problems themselves allow enough terms to be canceled out that we can turn our nasty nonlinear partial coupled differential equations into usually an ordinary differential equation like this, where we can solve it using simple integration and boundary values. All right, and so the last few slides are kind of padding, but it's just talking about how we use computational fluid dynamics to solve Navier-Stokes. I've talked a little bit about CFD in the past. The same idea applies. We just solve this exact set of equations iteratively on tiny little elements and add up all the solutions together. If you're interested in CFD, by all means, check out the slides. If there are other questions, feel free to come ask me. There will be no lecture on Wednesday. Remember, we're missing Wednesday, and instead I'll be posting sometime in the next 2 days a bunch of practice problems that you guys should take a look at and bring questions to Friday, which will be, we'll have a review session after class on Friday. Alright?
Basically clutches engage to like start rotation or something or to disengage. If you use a system of engagement, disengagement, get your